From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
Good evening. I'm Susan Vita, the Chief of the Music Division, and I'd like to welcome you tonight to our annual Founders Day concert, which is really a celebration of the birthday of Elizabeth Sprague Coolidge, whom all of us owe a lot to. It was her vision, her tremendous energy, and her very generous gifts, including this superb auditorium, that made it possible for the Library of Congress to become the home of one of the world's most distinguished concert series. Mrs. Coolidge was passionate about nurturing contemporary music, but some of you may know that she was also very interested in old music from the medieval, Renaissance, and Baroque periods. She also supported what was in her day the still relatively young discipline of musicology. So this evening, we have a very wonderful match for her interests with a very fine Orlando consort, masters of early music for the voice. We asked the artist to create a special program for this occasion, drawn from one of our Renaissance treasures, Labord Chansonnier. This beautiful 15th century French songbook is one of the most significant and best preserved chanson collections extant today. It's an important resource for scholars, and it's largely secular in contents. Copied by 5 different scribes, the Labord carries a whole world in its pages, the world of the great chateaus of the Loire Valley and their cosmopolitan aristocratic courts. But these songs were not only admired in France, many were among the biggest hit, the chart toppers of their era. And the fame of their composers extended across Europe. Names like Walter Fry, Johannes Ockeghem, and Guillaume Dufy. I do hope you'll take a moment to look at our exhibits in the foyer with the Labord Chansonnier as its centerpiece. Our conservation experts whisked this fragile, beautiful little volume with its magnificent illuminations out of our vault and created a special cradle to support it so that you can enjoy it tonight. And there are a number of other interesting items, including a volume from our rare book room that includes a first-person account of a performance of one of these songs. The occasion was an entertainment called the Feast of the Pheasant in 1454. So here we are in 2017, we're going to be listening to something that people were listening to in 1454 at the court of Philip the Good with costume performers and a fire-breathing dragon. We don't have that. We will have more of these Meet the Manuscript opportunities coming up for you. We're really pleased to be offering this focus as a theme for our 2017-18 season. We will be highlighting over 50 manuscripts from the Music Division's collections. You'll encounter handwritten scores from Schoenberg, Beethoven, Birtwistle, Rachmaninoff, and others. So thank you for coming and being part of our birthday celebration for Mrs. Coolidge. It's a joy to be part of the concert series she founded in 1925, and also a joy to share it with you.
Thank you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to our concert. It is indeed a unique privilege for us to be here tonight in the Coolidge Auditorium, bringing to life some of the songs that are from the Labord Chansonnier that are so beautifully displayed in the foyer. Let me reiterate, I'm sure most of you saw the display cases on your way in, but if for some reason you missed them or were not quite early enough to have a good look, I implore you to take some time in the intermission, because it's really fascinating for us as well as for you, I'm sure. You'll see a number of the pieces that we're singing displayed there in their original notation, including that piece by Walter Fry. I just want to make a few observations about our interpretation of the songs that you're going to hear tonight. The first thing to say is we won't perform the items that we're going to be singing, we won't perform all of them in their complete form. The reason for that is there are 106 songs in the Labord Chansonnier. We're not going to sing all of them, don't worry, but often, well, in most cases, these songs follow a very rigid poetic form, and we really want to give you as broad a survey as we can in the time available. So we'll be singing shorter versions of many of the songs. So I apologize in advance if your favorite rondeau is listed, and when we come to it, you don't hear 8 verses of it. The other thing that might strike you as slightly curious is our way of singing some of these chansons. Again, if I can refer to the display, for example, you'll see the beautiful De Toubien Plaine by Heine van Gisserhem on display up there, and you'll see that it's very clear, one of the part that Matthew will sing, the text is written out complete, so it's easy enough for him to sing the text to his music. In the underparts, in the lower parts, you just get the first few words and then you're left to your own devices. So I think it's fair to say that scholars are divided as to how this would have been interpreted. In some cases, it's thought the music would lend itself very well to being performed with instruments along with one voice. And, you know, that argument still rages, really. We do a sort of a mixture. In some cases, all of us will be singing the same text at the same time. In some cases, for example, in the piece by Caron that is coming up, there are no fewer than 3 different texts going on at the same time, only one of which is polite enough to be printed in your program. And in other cases where this problem arises, that there isn't enough music for the syllables of the poetry, we do a sort of vocalization instead of playing instruments. That's partly because we think it's a very beautiful way of expressing the music, but it's partly because if we were to play the instruments that we're able to play, you'd hear this music performed with a viola, 2 trumpets, and a saxophone. So we think that would be less appropriate. Anyway, I hope you enjoy what promises to be a fascinating evening. Thank you very much.
Amen. From the song that you've just heard by Bunois and the one we're about to sing, I think we can make a pretty confident assertion, namely that Bunois was in love. Now, the clue in the first one is that he's basically singing about a woman that's so beautiful that he's only going to wear the colours blue and yellow from now on. Now, blue and yellow were the colours in the heraldic family symbol of a young lady called Jacqueline d'Acaville. And the next clue about the next song is not at all subtle. The song, as you'll see, is called Jacqueline si n'attende. So it's a very, very obvious pun. From that, we move to a song for which I just love the whole reason for writing it. It's anonymous, but it concerns two composers represented in the Le Bord Chansonnier, Morton, an English composer, and Heiner. And it's about a spectacular party that they threw in Combray. And a measure of how good it was that the noise from this party could be heard in the town of Metz. Now, if I tell you that Metz is 25 miles from Combray, that'll give you some idea of what it was like. And then we finished the first half with two other items, a further song by Heiner, Allez Regret, followed by a mass movement from the Missa Allez Regret by Loisette Comper. Now, you'll see at different points in the program, we've paired a song with a mass movement. And that's because it's representative of what was a standard practice of the day. That if there was a good tune about the place, there's nothing quite like recycling. Some would call it today, some would call it plagiarism. But no, I don't think it was that. I think it was that when a tune was this good, other composers would very often adopt it as the basis, a melody or an inner line of a mass that they were going to write. So that's a combination of Heiner and Comper that will finish the first half.
Jacques. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to the second half. I hope you've all had a chance to have a look at the chansonnier, but somehow I think that's probably not possible given the size of the chansonnier and the size of the audience. However, perhaps afterwards, I do hope so, because it's a real treat for us to be able to see it that close. It's extraordinary. We're now kind of going basically to wallow in Dufay for a bit. Wonderful composer, the most famous composer of the early 15th century, certainly. In fact, we've just recorded a CD of his chanson, but that won't be out for about another 2 years, I'm afraid. We follow this, the first piece of this is Malheur au Coeur, another of his chanson. Then we give you simply the A and the B section, which is to say all the music of C'est le face et pâle, a very famous chanson. We do it for that reason because we're going to follow it with a mass by Dufay, a movement of a mass by Dufay based on that chanson. What happened was that you wouldn't be the top tune generally, the tune you hear at the top of the texture that is in the mass movement. It's the tenor part, the one buried in the middle. So in this case, for example, Mark, when we sing the chanson, sings the tenor part, and then Angus sings the tenor part in the Sanctus and Benedictus of the Dufay. The C'est le face et pâle, by the way, is the page to which the chansonnier is open. So you might want to have a particular look at that when you've heard this piece. Indeed, there's also a facsimile of, or a photo of, Genevieve Zonka, the next piece, which may be Dufay, maybe by Dufay, maybe by Gilles Vachois, no one is quite sure. And then again, there's a facsimile, a photo of the final piece of this group, which is by Jean Molinet, Tart ara mon coeur. Now, Molinet was a poet, basically. This is actually, I think, the only piece that we know that he wrote. And it begs the question of who wrote all the poetry. We tend to assume it was written by the composers, particularly in the case of those pieces by Bunuel. If he's writing about Jacqueline, surely that must be him writing the poetry. Unfortunately, we don't really know who wrote the poems in most cases, but we can pretend.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. It gives me the chance to just say one more time what a pleasure it's been to sing for you tonight. We do have one other piece in our folders. I'm afraid it's not from the Chansonnier. It's a piece by Josquin. It's one of two pieces actually ascribed to Josquin d'Ascanio. And research fluctuates as to whether this was the same famous Josquin or another Josquin, perhaps more famous as a dog handler, but you'll have to ask Donovan. In those days, anyone who wrote a good piece would put Josquin at the top of it. Makes sense. It is a beautiful little piece of frottola called In Te Domine Speravi.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.